let tonight's performance be the best performance.
Until he started making videos for me, I hated videos. And at the time, I'm not a fan of the video of pop videos. I think all the good ones have been done. And we were just about to do the one for Rockefeller Skank, and I'd flown to LA, and I got into my hotel room, and there was a VHS in my hotel room with this little note saying, "Hi Norman, I saw this guy dancing to Rockefeller Skank outside the Chinese theater, and so we filmed him and thought you might like to see it. Love, Spike." So I said, "Who's Spike?" And he said, "Spike Jonze, the video director." I said, "Sorry, don't know, I don't watch videos, I don't know who directors are." And the bloke who was commissioning the Rockefeller Skank video gave me like Spike's CV. And I'm like, ah, all the videos that I have enjoyed in the last 2 years have all been made by this bloke. They said, "Oh, we can't use this one because we didn't get clearance for the thing." And I said, "Well, if we can find this crackhead who's doing the stupid dancing to Rockefeller Skank, then we can, maybe Spike can film it again." And they went, "Actually, that is Spike." And for some reason, I thought he was black. Everyone, until he was in the Praise You video, everyone for some reason, I think because of Spike Lee, for some reason everyone just assumed he was black. Yeah, so I sent a message to Spike saying, "I thought that video was genius. It's a shame we can't use it, but will you make me one for me in the future?" And he said, "I'd love to." So for Praise You, I said, "Do you fancy doing Praise You?" And he said, "Oh yeah." He said, "I'd love to do that." And I said, "Will you do your stupid dancing and do it, just basically redo what you did for Rockefeller Skank?" And he said, "I'll go one better than that. We're going to do a dance troupe."
Sometimes you watch it and you watch the dancing. Sometimes you watch it and you just watch everybody's reactions. You can watch it, completely ignore the dancing, and just look at the looks on people's faces.
There was once when I was supposed to go and put some money in the hat, and Spike was supposed to sort of career into me and push me over or something, but he knocked me completely flying. And we both landed on top of the CD player that was doing the backing track. So we had to stop and start again. And the bit where the manager of the cinema comes out and switches the music off is actually real. It wasn't set up. He actually did come out and switch it off, and people started booing. I suspect some money changed hands at that point because we were allowed to switch it back on again. That was the third take. It had to be done in one take, and it had to annoy people. Because the original one, he kept bumping into people and no one knew what was going on, and that was the whole idea. It had to be kind of sort of commando style. So we all got in a van and we drove down to Santa Monica. Of course, what we didn't realise is there's tons of other buskers there, and there's people doing really good Michael Jackson impersonations. So they did one take there and nobody even looked. And half the point of the video was the interaction with the crowd, the bemused faces. And we did it there, and of course everyone ignored us. So we all got back in the van. And we literally just drove around Santa Monica looking for somewhere where we could annoy people. And we saw this queue and Spike said, "Yeah, right there, now." The team was, I think, 5 cameramen, the dancers obviously, me lurking around trying to do a sort of cameo appearance. And then we had a team of people that everyone who walked past, they had to grab them, get them to sign a release, give them $50 and get them to sign a release form. And I think that was probably the most expensive part of the video, was paying off all the extras, all the unwitting extras. The people in the queue had to not know what was going on. And because it was all filmed just on handheld DVs, it didn't look like a video shoot. It looked just like tourists mingling with the crowd who were filming this strange dancing. And you didn't realise that there was actually like 6 tourists, all of whom, you know, were actually professional cameramen. All the people in the crowd absolutely had no idea what was going on. And a lot of them must now see themselves in the best video of all time, the H1 best video of all time. It was such a crazy night. Because also, I'd been up all night. I'd played at the LA Coliseum the night before, and we kind of hadn't been to bed very much. So I wasn't at my best. So the whole evening was a bit of a blur, actually, to me. It was great seeing the dancers again when we did the MTV Awards, and they're going, we get recognised in the street, people ask for autographs. You know, like you said, at the time, they didn't know really know what they were letting themselves in for. What he did was he did his own moves and videoed them, and then taught the trans community dance project how not to dance. When I first saw the finished one, I thought, we've gone too far here. This really, you know, we were trying to make a cheap-looking crap video, and we've actually gone too far, and it's too cheap, too crap. American MTV wouldn't play it. The American record company wanted to make another one, and it was only because everybody else was playing it and raving about it, which is quite ironic since it got voted the best video of all time. And like I said, the record company actually said, right, we've got to make another video because they're not going to show this one. And I said, no, that's the video. You know, stick with it. You know, trust Spike. He knows what he's doing.